This week on Wealth Track, why accomplished global value investor Matthew McLennan has stocked up on gold in his First Eagle portfolios.
I think it's really reflective of the fact that gold is part of what I'd refer to as the ballast portion of our portfolio. We own it as a potential hedge.
Planning ahead for a sea change in financial markets this week on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
Funding provided by Morgan Le Fay Dreams Foundation, Clearbridge Investments, Royce Investment Partners, Matthews Asia, First Eagle Investment Management, and Strategus Asset Management.
Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. We have been living through an extraordinary period. It was a year ago that COVID was recognized as a global pandemic. And since then, over 100 million people have been stricken and more than 2 million have died. Economies were locked down, causing severe recessions. Central banks and governments responded with unprecedented amounts of monetary and fiscal stimulus. A worldwide effort by pharmaceutical companies to develop effective vaccines did so in record time. Millions are now in the process of being vaccinated. Equity markets suffered a short, severe correction early in 2020. In the U.S., the shortest bear market in its history, and to varying degrees have been rebounding ever since. U.S. markets have reached new peaks. Global economies are also recovering, with China and the U.S. rebounding at a rapid pace. Well, is the worst behind us? Are world economies and markets on a sustained path of recovery, as many believe, or are there hidden risks? That is a concern of today's guest. He is Matthew McLennan, a noted global manager, head of the global value team at First Eagle Investment Management, where he oversees more than $100 billion in assets, including several funds. His flagship First Eagle Global and the First Eagle Overseas funds, which he inherited from legendary value investor Jean-Marie Aviard in 2008, carry four-star ratings from Morningstar, as well as their silver medalist analyst rating. Each has outperformed both its index and category since inception. First Eagle is a sponsor of WealthTrack, but McLennan has been a WealthTrack guest for years because of his track record and, as Morningstar puts it, his unusual conservative approach. Long before the pandemic, McLennan had been monitoring emerging geopolitical and financial risks globally, which he says were exacerbated by COVID. I asked him to give us some specifics.
We are focused on a number of different risks, and I think that the pandemic has in some ways brought forward those risks, but they're being concealed by the market's enthusiasm right now for what many refer to as the great reflation trade. And indeed, it's true. When we look bottom up across many sectors of the economy, we're seeing signs of vibrancy, whether it's tightness in the semiconductor space, the strong demand for cloud equipment, or rising pricing trends in the insurance industry, or booming suburban construction across a range of different fields, including factory and farm automation equipment. We are seeing signs of strength, and business optimism has been strong. But I think one has to pause and reflect on the fact, what comes after this boom in demand? Is it correct that the government should be administering such a large dose of fiscal stimulus to a patient that's already ostensibly self-healing?
In the meantime, you said that this reflation trade, the reopening boom, it's for real, right? So we're talking about a substantial pickup in economic activity. As a long-term investor, how much attention are you paying to what's going on short-term? And do you think that this reopening that we're seeing, and it's a global phenomenon, has legs?
Well, it's clear that we're going to see a period of strong demand growth. I mentioned the bottom-up organic healing process that's already happening in the economy, and we're about to administer another dose of fiscal stimulus. The question is, what's already priced in markets? The problem for markets is that credit spreads are now below where they were before COVID struck. Commodity prices are above where they were, whether you're talking about copper or oil or agricultural commodities. In fact, they're above their 4 or 5 year moving averages. And the stock market's already hit a new peak. In fact, it trades at a multiple of the trailing peak level of earnings. It's well above where it was before COVID. And so the market's already pricing in an anticipatory sense a period of strong growth. And so The issue for the markets is going to be, as we go through this period of economic growth over the next several quarters, what does the market start to turn its attention to as we look into 2022 and beyond? And there, the picture is a lot fuzzier for us.
So, Matt, what do you think the market might start paying attention to once we're, you know, beyond this kind of initial boom period that we seem to be entering into?
So the boom has really been fueled by unprecedented monetary and fiscal stimulus combined. And we see an outlook even into an economic recovery for a fiscal deficit that is a mid-teens percentage of GDP. The question is, how do we revert to more normal levels of monetary growth and more normal fiscal deficits once growth recovers from its cyclical lows? The concern I have is that we're on a structural path towards a lower productivity growth world. We already had the mix shift in the economy towards services, which is lower productivity growth than manufacturing. We have, as a second order consequence of COVID, a vast increase in the role that the government is playing in the economy. And the government is not the most productive actor in the economy. By virtue of low interest rates, we see a range of zombie firms being kept alive. And on top of all of that, I think it's pretty clear that we're going to see an increasing web of regulatory initiatives coming the way of the markets in coming years. And so if I add all of that up, demographics, the mix shift to services, a bigger role for government, more complex regulation. It's my belief that when we get to 2022 and beyond, that the trend rate of growth in the US economy could be quite modest. It could be 1.5%. That presents a huge headwind to policymakers. How do you tighten a 15% fiscal deficit back towards a more normal 2-3% without tipping the economy into recession? This is going to be a serial risk that policymakers have to face in coming years. And so all of that multiple re-rating we got from the stimulus could start to turn to multiple de-rating as the market digests those challenges in the years ahead.
So in the meantime, we are seeing recovery and we're seeing, you know, corporate profits, for instance. What's your outlook for corporate profits and the companies that you're invested in? You know, what are they telling you?
Bottom up, we're seeing encouraging signs. And so I would expect that this is going to be a pretty strong environment for corporate profits. Corporate profits peaked back in 2018 and 2019 before COVID at around $150 a share for the S&P 500. The fact that the market's trading at closer to 4,000 today means that it's probably pricing closer to $200 of earnings power. And maybe that's possible, you know, if we've increased the monetary base by 25% and if we have larger fiscal deficits. And let me just highlight one point here. Large fiscal deficits are good for corporate profit margins because what they do is they produce more income than would have otherwise existed for the private sector. Mm-hmm. And so if we have this combination of a bigger nominal economy and wide fiscal deficits, you'd expect top-down corporate profits would be quite good. It's consistent with what we're hearing bottom-up. The problem is the markets may already be pricing a big chunk of this.
So when you look at the companies that you're investing in, you know, basically, how expensive are they? Because you're a value investor and you're looking for companies with, you know, durable businesses. How difficult is it to find companies that are good values?
It's definitely been more challenging in the recent month or two, given the level of markets. I would say towards the back end of last year, we saw more opportunities because the market was far more bifurcated. You had a small group of very hot concept stocks trading at generationally high levels of valuation. But since the vaccine news and since we've started to see evidence of the case count of COVID going down, some of the more mature areas of the market have already started to recover as well. And so I would not describe this as a very rich backdrop in terms of the opportunity set. I think it's an environment where one has to adjust expectations to more rational levels. I mean, after all, if the long-term rate of interest on a government bond is below 2% and the dividend yield on the equity market is below 2%, maybe we're just going to be in a low to mid-single digit return world. I think we have at least the advantage of being able to selectively look at the market bottom up and identify businesses that have a character that we're comfortable with and be selective on when we commit capital to them. But, you know, from my perspective, the goal in this kind of environment should be to find companies that you think are priced for high single digit returns, with resilient businesses. This is not the kind of environment where you want to throw caution to the wind looking for the next double or triple.
You know, you mentioned that there's a reflation trade going on. Have you made any adjustments to the First Eagle portfolios and the Global Fund or the Overseas Fund that are in recognition of the fact that, you know, that the cyclicals are coming back?
So we've always had an all-weather portfolio philosophy. And so in some ways, our resilience last year being down less than the market, but not up as much as a hot growth market, and our sound performance this year has really reflected the fact that we've had this all-weather portfolio construction. We do have a range of investments in different industries that are well-positioned to benefit from the mature economy reopening. And that would be across sectors that you would obviously think of, such as financials or energy or the like, but it would be more broadly distributed than that. We have a lot of investments in the real estate space, in the professional services arena, freight logistics and the like. All of these companies will benefit from the mature economy reopening. But we've also kept a foot in the new economy. For many years, we've been a holder of a number of software companies that are benefiting from the cloud.
Right, Oracle being one. And
we've had investments in the semiconductor space.
Right.
I think the difference that in our portfolio from what you'd see in the market as a whole is that we apply quite a disciplined valuation filter. So we're not exposed to the hottest areas in that market. And certainly you're not seeing us playing in SPACs or any other more speculative IPO activity. The final thing I will say, though, is given the uncertainties that I mentioned to you before, we have a component of our portfolio that represents ballast. And we've taken the opportunity, while some of the higher quality staples have derated, to build some of our positions there. These are grinded out cash flow generative businesses that may not have the most short-term elasticity to a recovery in the economy, but are soundly priced for the decade ahead.
Are you finding more opportunities for the kinds of companies that you're looking for at the right price in overseas markets?
It's probably a fair statement that the overseas market valuations are a little less demanding than what we've seen in the United States. In some ways, the overseas markets have had less money supply growth and they've had less fiscal stimulus. And so perhaps there's been less reason for re-rating. But right. If you just look at the markets as a whole, I mean, the MSCI world is roughly 2/3 US, but the US is only 5% of the world's population. And so, for us, we've always tended to have a little bit more balance in the portfolio. We have seen a range of opportunities, not just within the United States, but outside the United States. And so we've selectively bought into some positions in Latin America, for example, very cash flow generative businesses that have been out of favor due to obviously issues relating to COVID, but longer term that are stable quality businesses, for example, in the brewing industry. We've seen opportunities in some of the holding companies around the world that often incorporate a double discount. And so it's fair to say that we've also found opportunity from time to time in Japan, which has been an old favorite for us in terms of finding good businesses with good balance sheets at reasonable prices. I think an example of a company like that would be one of the companies that we added to during the crisis. And it's a good example of an eclectic holding that we would have in our portfolio is a company like Hoshizaki. Mm-hmm. Which is a world leader in ice making machines for restaurants and for commercial cafeterias and the like. So the business environment was definitely difficult for them, but they had net cash on the balance sheet. It's a company that's gradually growing its market share position. It's expanding its footprint in kitchens beyond ice makers to commercial refrigerators and even the warm side in ovens and the like. And so this is a company that has years of sustained growth ahead of it at a modest clip, but it's visible, and where we were able to add at a price that was undemanding relative to its capacity to generate free cash flow in a more normal environment. And it's just an example of the kind of eclectic opportunities that exist in a market like Japan.
Let me ask you about another kind of feature of your portfolios, and that's your positions in gold and gold-related investments. And I know in the Global Fund, I think bullion is your largest single position.
And I think it's really reflective of the fact that gold is part of what I would refer to as the ballast portion of our portfolio. We own it as a potential hedge. As we look forward, though, beyond this recovery, I mentioned to you that we have extremely limited policy space in front of us. and that the potential solution to sovereign debt problems may entail a period of very low interest rates for a long period of time, particularly in real terms. And at low real interest
rates.
And
again, real terms is versus nominal is when you take into account inflation.
That's exactly right, Consuelo. Yeah. So, for example, the 10-year bond yield has moved back up to about 1.6%. But if you look at long-term inflation expectations in the bond market where they're traded, they're north of 2%. So we still have a negative real interest rate. Gold tends to serve as a sound potential hedge in a negative real interest rate environment. And if we think we're going to need negative real interest rates for quite some time to right the fiscal problems we have, gold serves as a potential hedge there. The second thing I would say is that the dollar over the last decade has been strong. It went through a period of weakness over the last year, but it's been stronger a little bit lately with all of this fiscal stimulus. But the dollar suffers from a bit of a problem. The rate of money supply growth is faster in the United States than it is internationally. We have trade deficits, whereas our main trading counterparts, whether it's Europe, Japan, or China, have trade surpluses. So we need to offer interest rate carry to keep the currency stable. If we're going to be locked into a low real interest rate environment, that could present certain risks to the dollar long term. And so we view gold still as a sound potential hedge against what could be the looming monetary mess ahead of us. Frankly, gold has derated substantially relative to the value of risk assets, and I think you're likely to see it play a role in our portfolio, either until it's substantially above where it's cleared at its recent premiums, or stocks are trading substantially below their recent bear market levels, and we see the opportunity to deploy it in good businesses at good prices.
And what about the dollar's position as a safe haven? It's the, you know, the place in times of trouble that people go to. What is its position now, as far as that's concerned?
We could be at a cuspy moment in its positioning as the world safe haven. Mm-hmm. And I know that the dollar behaved as a safe haven during the crisis in the first quarter of 2020 when we had COVID, it strengthened. But it's hard to retain safe haven status if you don't have credible fiscal and monetary policy long term.
Another notable feature of your portfolios at First Eagle, again, the two mutual funds, but let's talk about the First Eagle Global Fund in particular, is your position in U.S. Treasuries is zero. I mean, that you're an outlier in the world allocation category. So little faith in U.S. Treasuries. And as a matter of fact, I think you have a minuscule position in fixed income investments, period.
So we've chosen, we do have close to 10% of our portfolio in cash and cash equivalents. And I guess the way we've chosen to invest that is that we have mostly non-financial industrial commercial paper, which gives us a little yield relative to T-bills. We have been willing to own T-bills, I will state. But we've been less enticed by extending duration into traditional U.S. treasuries because, when they were yielding below 1%, we saw less hedge value in the treasuries because they could only trade to 0%. And we saw more downside risk if yields were to back up with the economy actually strengthening. And the more we sort of thought about it, the more we felt that we had the benefit of that potential hedge in owning gold. As I mentioned before, gold has a very tight inverse correlation with U.S. real interest rates. Uh-huh. Yet the supply growth in gold is less than 2% a year, as opposed to the double-digit supply growth of dollars. And so for our money, gold has traded like a tip, but with a better long-term drift rate to it in terms of its capital appreciation than a U.S. tip. And so we've felt that gold, while more volatile in the short term, has been a safer place to be long term to preserve purchasing power.
Do you envision a precipitating event or a series of events that are going to cause a re-rating of the market, i.e. A correction from the current bull run that we've had?
Look, the honest answer, Consuelo, is I have no idea. And if I did, I think we'd be far more successful than we have been at First Eagle.
In market timing.
Exactly. But I can suggest a few things to reflect on here. I think the first thing is, if this period of economic robustness continues, within a year, we could have erased the output gap and financial conditions could start to feel much tighter, much sooner than markets expect. We have this unique window in time where both Congress and the Fed are very focused on getting back to the full level of employment as quickly as possible. And the Fed has told you it will wait not only until it sees that, but it sees inflation. And so markets tend not to like inflation. And if the Fed is seen as being perhaps behind the curve while the economy is running hot, that could bring some pressure to bear in currency markets. Mm-hmm. Then that could lead to a feedback cycle, a sort of a stagflationary feeling in coming years, like we saw perhaps in the 1970s. We're not saying that's the core scenario, but it's certainly a risk. And markets dislike stagflation with a degree of abhorrence that's hard to imagine. You know, typically markets in those environments trade at less than half the multiples than today's markets. I think the second thing is that there are geopolitical challenges out there in the world. I think, it's fair to say that China tested American resolve on Hong Kong. Right. Will they test America's resolve on Taiwan? I just don't know. But an event like that, that you would think of as a black swan event, could, have ramifications for markets. And we've had a discussion today that's been very focused on the US, but what if China also has to slow its rate of monetary growth to deal with its excessive level of debt? That demand pulse that we've seen has not just come from the United States, it's come from China. And the one final thing I'll say is when you look at business corporate sentiment, mm-hmm. The ISM survey, for example, it's pretty close to generational highs. And so more often than not, something happens that takes sentiment back towards more normal levels, and the market tends to derate when that happens. And so we don't know what the specific catalyst will be that will take markets down, but it could be some combination of tighter financial conditions, the fear of getting into behind the curve territory for policy and stagflation, a geopolitical event, or it could simply be a series of regulatory shocks that make business sentiment moderate somewhat from its current high levels.
And the point is, you, with your First Eagle portfolios, are preparing for those possibilities now, as opposed to waiting, reacting when they happen.
Yeah, absolutely right. We certainly want to make sure that we've battened down the hatches before the storm was visible on the horizon. And it comes back to the comment I made before about being an all-weather portfolio in construction. We want to have some businesses that will participate in the economic recovery, mm-hmm. but we want to also have some more stable businesses and some ballast, that potential hedge in gold, and so a little bit of cash for a rainy day.
Matt, one investment for a long-term diversified portfolio. Is there anything that we should all own some of?
You know, it's an interesting time. I'd like to go back to one of the important principles I tried to get across before, which is that we're in a moment where people have a fear of missing out. Right. So when you think of what's an appropriate investment right now, I'd focus on something that offers sound return potential rather than speculative or extraordinary return potential. And so, we're very focused on businesses that we see a line of sight to the ability to potentially generate high single-digit returns through a combination of mid-single-digit free cash flow yields and the ability to grow at a measured pace over time. And I'll give you two for the price of one here. If you look at our U.S. Top 10 holdings, two names that would be in that list would be a name like Colgate, world leader in toothpaste with nearly 40% market share, or a company like C.H. Robinson, which is the leading freight broker for trucking in the United States. Now, both of these companies will benefit from a stronger economy in one form or another, but they don't need a really strong economy to persist. They're both very free cash flow generative. They both trade at reasonable multiples relative to their history. They both have the capacity to grow at a measured pace, and they both have management teams that have distributed the free cash flow to shareholders over time. So seeking a sound and sustainable long-term return is often the best policy at a time where people have fear of missing out on extraordinary returns.
All right, Matt McLennan, thanks so much for joining us, as always, from First Eagle. We really appreciate it.
Thanks so much for having me on the show.
At the close of every Wealth Track, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is a familiar one. It is own some gold for all the reasons McLennan has mentioned. Ballast in a portfolio during volatile times. Its historic role is a store of value. It's a hard asset in a world of intangibles. And it is a non-correlated asset in most portfolios. All reasons to have some of the precious metal as part of your wealth preservation strategy. Well, next week in part two of our interview with Richard Bernstein, he shares his day trading antithesis, time-tested strategies for successful investing using long holding periods. In this week's extra feature, Matt McLennan will recommend two biographies of historical figures that are still relevant today. For those of you on social media, please follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and our YouTube channel. Thanks for watching. Have a happy Easter weekend and make the week ahead a healthy, profitable, and productive one.